Let us pray together while you're standing. Loving Father in heaven, once again, I thank you for the privilege you have allowed us to come into your presence one more time. Tonight, Father, we invoke your presence. Come near us. As we open your word, your people are waiting to hear from you. We thank you in advance, Lord, for coming by this tent. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I'd like to say good evening to everyone. Good evening to everyone. Good evening to everyone. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I want to thank the praise team for that wonderful music. I don't know about you, but my soul has already been blessed. And right now, we want to just get right into the Word of God this evening. I'm glad to see you. I hope you brought your Bibles. If you brought your Bibles, just wave them in the air. You brought your Bibles. Amen. Amen. They tell me when you wave your Bibles in the air, you give the devil a headache. And so tonight, let's give him a headache one more time. Just wave your Bibles in the air. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All right. We're going to get right into the Word of God tonight. There's some things I want to share with you as the people of God. But you know, tonight there is one statement that will not let me rest. And I want to read it again. I've shared it with you before. And I want to share it with you tonight because, again, I want you to understand, my brothers and my sisters, that God loves us more than we can ever imagine. And I want you to understand that God is trying to pull us out of this dilemma called sin. And we need to cooperate with him. I want you to listen to this statement here again. I read it before. It says, even as sinners, man was in a different position from that of Satan. Lucifer in heaven had sinned in the light of God's glory. Now, when I read that, I really took my time and I said to myself, the people of God need to understand that Lucifer in heaven sinned against God, and there was nothing else God could reveal to Lucifer. To him, as to no other created being, was given a revelation of God's love. God shared with Lucifer his love, his mercy, and his grace. And there was nothing else God could share with Lucifer that he had already shared with him. He'd given him everything. Understanding the character of God, knowing his goodness, Satan chose to follow his own selfish, independent will. In spite of all the mercy that God had extended to Lucifer, he still chose to fight against God. Now that blows my mind. Here you find the fourth most intelligent being in the universe. The Bible says he sealed up the sum. The brothers sang all part harmony. And as I said before, he not only could play an instrument, but he was an instrument. He not only sat down to a piano, but he could be a piano. He not only had to play a guitar, but he was a guitar. The Bible says he sealed up the sum. He stood in the presence of God, and there was nothing else God could reveal to him. This choice he made was final. In fact, in the book Story of Redemption, Ellen White says when Jesus and the angels, they tried to warn him about his demise and his end, and they pleaded with him. They begged him. They said, Lucifer, please change your mind about God. And he walked out on God and refused to change his mind. The Bible says that Lucifer fell. Now it says here, there was no more that God could do to save him. I mean, God did everything he could do, but there was nothing else he could do. But man, you and me, man or mankind was deceived. See, somehow the devil had pulled the wool over man's eyes and man was deceived by the devil. You see, men and women today, people are destroying themselves because they don't understand that God loves them. They're running from God. And whenever purpose is not known, abuse is inevitable. God, the great lover, is trying to develop a relationship with you and me. And tonight, listen to this. Man was deceived. His mind was darkened by Satan's sophistry. The devil, with all of his cunningness, with all of his power, he came and he deceived mankind. The height and the depth of the love of God, he did not know. Man didn't know it. I mean, we were mortals. We were finite, made in the image of God. We did not have the privileges that Lucifer had. And so man did not know the height and the depth and the love of God. For him, there was hope
in a knowledge of God's love for him. I repeat tonight, for him there was hope in a knowledge of God's love for mankind, boys and girls, women, men and women. There was a hope that somehow, if they could only come to know God, if God could just reveal himself to mankind, there was this hope that once they saw God, their lives would change. If they could only see Christ lifted up, the Bible says, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. God said, if somehow, if I could just come near them, if I could just let them know that I love them, if only somehow I could just come close to them, I would let them know I love them. But because God is so holy and so pure, if he came as God, he would destroy us. And so he had to come as a man in order to identify with us. And now today, you find church, a Bible, the spirit of prophecy, preachers, parents, elders, teachers, all of this is an attempt that God is using to try to reach us with the love of God. And so tonight, it says, by beholding his character, he might be drawn back to God. You see, tonight, my brothers and sisters, if we would just come to see God, if somehow, if we could just get a glimpse of his glory. I remember when Moses was in the mountain and he wanted to see God. And he said, look, he said, God, why don't you let me see you? And God says, Moses, I can't let you see me. He says, if I show you who I am, I would destroy you because you are mortal. He says, but what I'm going to do, I'm going to hide you in the cleft of the rock and I'm going to pass by you. I'm going to put my hand over you, and once I pass by, I'm going to move my hand and I'm going to let you see what I'm all about. And the Bible says when God passed by, he moved his hand and Moses saw goodness, he saw mercy, he saw love, he saw kindness, he saw God's attributes. And when he saw this, the Bible says he saw the backside of God. God couldn't let him see him as he was or he would die. And tonight, my brothers and sisters, God yearns for a relationship with us tonight. You know, he wants a relationship with us. And in the Bible, there is this divine romance. And tonight I want you to see this with me. There is in the Bible this divine romance between God and his church. God and his woman. All he wants is a relationship with her, but she keeps running from him. God says, baby, why you keep running from me? And all I want to do is bless you, honey child. All I want to do is love you. You see, I'm jealous because can't nobody treat you like I can. You see, I get upset when I see you settling for second best when I want to bless you. And so God says, I'm a jealous God because nobody can love you, girlfriend, like I can. See, if I get next to you, see, you my woman and I want to bless you, but you keep on running out on me. And God says tonight, I want a relationship with you. And so tonight, I want you to look with me in the Word of God. Turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 29, beginning with verse 11. Jeremiah chapter 29. See, all of this tonight is an attempt that we might see the character of God. And once you come to see God, somehow, once you come to know him, your life is going to change. Jeremiah 29, verse 11 says this. God says, for I know the thoughts. Now, I want you to see this. This is God speaking to us tonight. Jeremiah 29, 11, God says tonight in his word, Jeremiah 29, verse 11, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you. God says, I know how I feel about you. I know what I'm thinking about you, young people. He says, I know my thoughts, saith the Lord. Thoughts of what? Thoughts of what? Are you, if you're with me, say it. Thoughts of what? Thoughts of what? Peace. Thoughts of peace. God says, I have thoughts of peace towards you. He says, and not of what? Evil, to give you an expected end. God says, I want to give you a future. That's what the Hebrew word. God says, I want to give you a future. I want to give you hope. I want to give you something to live for. And tonight, my brothers and sisters, when you have something to live for, you can make it through today. When you got a tomorrow, today is a piece of cake. When you got a hope, when you got a future, if you got a heaven to gain and a hell to shun, life is worth living. And that's one thing I like about life, and that is, this is not it. This is just passing through. This is just a pilgrim's ground. This is not not my home. My God is preparing a mansion for me somewhere. And if I just hold on, he has an expected end for me. He has a future for me. God has allowed me to be born, and now he wants a relationship with me. He says in verse 12, then shall you call on me. God says you're going to call on me, and you shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. You see, my brothers and sisters, God is not elusive. God is not trying to hide from us. God is not playing games with us. God wants us to know the revelation, the plan of salvation, so we can be saved and get out of this world of mess. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of this world. I want to go home. I got a place called heaven waiting on me. I got a mansion with my name on it, and I can't wait to get there. God is trying to save us, but before he saves us, he wants us to know him as our personal savior. You shall seek me. You shall find me when you shall search for me with all your heart. Now, the question tonight is, how can you find God? Where is God? I mean, where are you going? How can I know I'm going the right way? With all the different denominations in the world today, with all the different religions, and with everybody saying something about God, how can I be assured that I'm going in the right direction? How can I really know that if I put my best foot forward and as I start living for God, that I'm doing the right thing? How can I know tonight? Well, you know, one thing I like about God, he's not going to play games with us. He's not going to shuck and jive us. He's not going to trick us. He's not going to play with cards under the table. He's not going to cross his fingers behind his back and tell us one thing and do another. God is going to be consistently the same all the time. Notice what it says in Amos chapter 3, verse 7. Amos chapter 3, verse 7. Whether you realize it or not, there's a big final exam coming. If you don't get the proper notes, you can't be ready for this exam. You got to get some notes. And the Bible says in Amos chapter 3, verse 7, surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secrets unto the servants, the prophets. God says, I'm not going to do anything in secret. God says, I'm not going to trick you. God says, I'm going to tell you just like it is. I'm not going to play games with you. I'm going to reveal to you everything you need to know about the plan of salvation so that you can be saved, because I want you not only to have a future, but I want you to have heaven as your home. That's what God says tonight. He says, God does nothing in secret, but he reveals his secrets unto his servants, the prophets, who in return reveal them to us, the people of God. Now, I want you to go with me to a story. You know, the best way I can illustrate this tonight is through a story. And there is a story in the Word of God that I want to share with you tonight, because if somehow, as we study the Word of God, if our eyes could be open, our lives would be changed. Turn with me to Ephesians before we get into this story. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. And notice what the Bible says. You see, the problem tonight, my brothers and sisters, is that the devil has deceived us. With his sophistry, he has pulled the curtains over our eyes, or he has allowed clouds of doubt to come in. He has allowed circumstances to hedge us in so we can't see God. And sometimes difficult times come, hard times come, problems come that we can't understand, and we want to assume that God is not around or he's not near, but somehow if God could open up our eyes, we could see his goodness. Ephesians chapter 1, notice what the Bible says. Ephesians chapter 1, and I'm reading verse 17. Now I need you to, if you don't have your Bibles, write these texts down or turn with me in your Word. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17, notice what it says. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of what? The spirit of wisdom. The spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of who? Him. Paul says, I wish God could give you the wisdom and the revelation of the knowledge that is in Christ Jesus. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened. that you may know what is the hope of his calling. God says tonight, I wish you could know the hope of your calling. I wish you could know what God has in store for you. If your eyes could be open and if you could see the blessings that God has waiting on you, your life would change. If you can only see the fact that God has something in store for you, if your eyes could be open, I guarantee you tonight, you wouldn't live the way you live. I guarantee you tonight, if you could see the hope of the calling, and if your eyes could be open, your life would change. When you have something to live for, your life changes. The reason why a lot of people do dumb things is because they don't have hope. When there is no tomorrow, you live like there is no present. Now listen to what the Bible says. I wish your eyes could be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what is the riches of the glory of the inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power. God says tonight, I wish your eyes could be open so that you could understand what is the hope of your calling and your wisdom of the revelation of God, what he has in store for you. If you could only know what God has in store for you, your life would change. Oh, tonight, if you could just see God, if you could just understand what he's doing for you. Well, what's the problem? Why can't we see God? I mean, why don't I understand God? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Turn there with me. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And I want us to understand that the biggest problem that you and I face tonight is that we can't see the things of God. That's the big problem. You see, the devil has rocked us to sleep. In a world in which we live in, we have become so comfortable with what is around us, that we don't understand that there is a God that's calling us to a high destiny. We become so preoccupied with our problems. We become so concerned about our situations that we don't understand the calling that God has put on our lives. You are bigger than the mess that you are in. I can't stress it enough. God has a destiny for you. God has called you out of darkness into this marvelous light. You are part of the three angels' message, and God wants to use you as an instrument in his hand to save broken humanity. God has called you to be a minister of reconciliation. There are people out there who are lost in darkness. There are people out there who don't know their way, and somehow God has come into your life. God has touched your mind. God has given you the truth, because somebody needs to know about this God, because once you come to know him, your life will never be the same. He'll change your life. You'll walk right. You'll eat right. You'll talk right. You'll begin to treat people right. You'll treat yourself right. You'll treat your family members right when you love God and come to know him. But somehow our eyes have to be opened. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Now notice what it says. Paul says, beginning with verse 4, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Now he says this, howbeit, we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not. We speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not. The wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. The world can't understand it. They don't know what's going on. We speak this mystery. It's a wisdom, and it is a mystery of God. Even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes, now check this next verse, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. If they had known what they were doing, they would have never crucified Jesus. If they had just had their eyes open, they would have never crucified the Son of God. And you know, my brothers and sisters, when the prodigal son said, Dad, I want my inheritance because I want to live my own life. What he was actually saying was, Dad, I wish you were dead so that I could do my own thing. Every time we sin, we are saying to God, God, I wish you were dead so I could live my own life. God, I wish you were out of the picture because my life is more important than doing your will. God, I wish you were dead. The Bible says if only they had known what they were doing, they would have never crucified the Son of God. And my brothers and sisters, if we could only know that every time we sin, we break the heart of God. Every time we sin, we crucify our Lord afresh. Every time we sin, we are saying, God, I wish you were dead. And my brothers and sisters, I would have to ask the question, if God was dead, who would wake you up in the morning? If God was dead, who would keep your heart beating all night long? If God was dead, who would give the birds the melody that they sing? If God was dead, who would cause the earth to turn on its axis? If God was dead, who would cause the stars to have a twinkle? If God was dead, who would wake you up in the morning? If God was dead, who would keep the blood flowing through your body? If God was dead, we would all be messed up, because without God, there is nothing that will stabilize the universe. Sin says, I want my own way, and it doesn't matter about anybody else. If only we could have our eyes open, we would never hurt our master, Jesus Christ. The devil has pulled the wool over our eyes, and somehow he has tried to get all of us to go along with his lie. And that is, God is not fair. But I've come to tell you tonight, God is fair, and somehow we need our eyes open so that we can make a decision about how we feel about Jesus Christ. And one thing I like about God, he's going to extend to us the privilege of knowing his love. That's why the statement says, it was this hope that in a knowledge of God, man would be drawn back to God. If man somehow could understand the plan of salvation, if somehow man could come to know me, I know it would change their lives. If somebody could just share with them how much I love them, it would change their hearts. That's why the Bible says here, verse 9, but as it is written, I have not seen. Now, tonight I want you to understand this Bible text. Many people have taken this text out of context. This text right here, you should never, ever say this text again out of context. I've heard many Christians take this text out of context. They say, girlfriend, let me tell you something. I have not seen, ear have not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man what God had prepared for them that love him. I've heard people say that. I've heard people say, well, we don't know what we're going to get when we get to heaven. I have not seen, ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man. But notice what the Bible says. It says this, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But the next verse says this, but God hath revealed it unto them by his Spirit. That's what the next verse says. The next verse says, but. Now, you know what but is? But is a conjunction. Conjunction, junction, what's your function? You know what a conjunction does? A conjunction erases everything that comes before it, and it introduces a new thought. When it says, I have not seen, ear have not heard, nor hath it entered into the heart of men, but God has revealed it to them by his Spirit. In other words, God hath revealed to you and me only if we're in the Spirit the things that he's preparing for us. If you're walking in the Spirit of God, God is going to reveal to you the things that he's preparing for you. If you could just get the wisdom and the revelation of God's love and understand that you're going to be around as long as God is going to be around, I'm going to hobnob with unfallen beings. Notice what the next verse says. For what man knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of a man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man except the Spirit of God. Now verse 14 says, but the natural man, that's the problem. Lord have mercy. The natural man, that's our problem. The natural man, that's our problem. The natural man, a man that's born in sin, cannot understand the things of God. That's why, young people, I do understand and I do sympathize with you why church is so difficult to get into, because spiritual things are spiritually discerned. I want you to know tonight, I understand. I do understand. Remember, I started off by saying, how do we know the will of God? How can we find God's way? First of all, I said God is going to reveal to us his secrets through the prophets. God is going to take the initiative, but you know the problem is? The problem is the natural man cannot receive the things of God. It's difficult. You will never understand what church is about until you get born again. Are you with me? I, you know, when I was growing up, I couldn't understand how people could talk about a God they couldn't see. It was difficult. I mean, my mother was talking about the Lord will make a way. I'm like, I can't even see him. How are you going to make a way? And I don't even know where he is. And I heard old folk talking about, well, you may not be able to understand him, but he'll take away your sorrows. He'll take away your problems in the by and by. And I used to always hear him say, he may not come when you want him, but he'll come right on time. You know, I wondered about this God. I couldn't understand it. But it wasn't until I was 17 years of age. And I want to share with you a testimony here. It wasn't until I was 17 years of age. And one night I was laying on a couch. I was young. Now, young folk, I want you to understand, I just didn't get converted last week. I was 17. I was young, and I was robust, and I had little muscles and biceps here. And I was playing high school football. In fact, I knew I was going to be a pro football player one day. But one day, 1977, I was 17 years of age, and I was laying down on a couch. And all of a sudden, my mother, for some reason that night, she wasn't even a Seventh-day Adventist yet. She was a Baptist, but she had gotten this little book from my aunt, and the book was entitled Steps to Christ. And she was reading it out loud. Now, I'm laying on the couch minding my own business. I didn't ask for anybody to read anything to me, but I was just laying there. All of a sudden, as she was reading this particular book, she says that I got down on my knees after a while and I prayed for about 2 or 3 minutes. All I remember is going upstairs in the restroom, looking in the mirror, and I start crying like a baby for about 15, 20 minutes. I thought I was losing my mind because, see, as I was crying, have you ever seen that commercial, Zestfully Clean? You know, as I was crying, it seemed like I was being washed. And as I was crying, it seemed like my guilt was being washed away. And after a while, young people, I came back downstairs and I said to my mother, I said, I'm going to church this Sabbath without doors. And she looked at me, she said, what? You going where? She said, now wait a minute, come again. She said, wait a minute, testing, 1, 2, 3. Did I hear right? I said, I'm going to church without doors. Now, I want to say that before this experience, I didn't understand church. I didn't understand the Bible. I didn't understand the Word of God. It didn't make sense. But spiritual things are spiritually discerned. When God awakens your heart, when God comes in and converts you, let me tell you what happens. When you get converted, you don't get a new house. You get a new landlord. Stay with me. Stay with me. I want to teach a little bit. When you get converted, see, I was confused when I was young. When I first got converted, I thought that when you get converted, it's like a magical wand that's waved over you, and you're going to be perfect just like that. You're not going to want to sin anymore. You're just going to walk all the way to glory. You're just ready to go to heaven, just waiting on the Lord coming. Thank you, G. Come get me. You're waiting on translation, but that's not what happens, and you realize that too in your life. When you get converted, converted is simply like a radio. When you have a radio and you have the antenna down, it can't pick up any stations. When you take an antenna and you pull it up and you lift it up, it begins to pick up stations. When a person gets converted, it simply means now they can pick up the wavelengths of glory. They now can appreciate and understand the things of God. It doesn't mean you're perfect when you get converted. It simply means now you can pick up God's wavelengths. You can hear him talking now. You can hear him speaking now. And now it begins to make sense. But as you eat the Word of God, as you study, you begin to grow. That's where your growth comes in, because temptation, it reveals character. It does not build character. I'll say that again. Temptation only reveals character. It does not build character. What builds character is spending time early in the morning before the sun comes up, getting on your knees before your God and saying, Lord, I need power to live right. I'm reading about you. I understand you. I love you. And I want to walk the way you want me to walk. And so God, come into my life and help me today. And as you walk through that day, you start thinking about your walk and your talk with your God that morning. And that's how you grow. It is through a relationship with God. You see, when you get converted, you get a new landlord. The Holy Ghost gave me this one. When you get a new landlord, you still have the same old tenants in your house. That's the flesh. Now, the tenants they don't get converted, the landlord, you get a new landlord. Now, when the flesh beckons for something, now you say, for instance, here you are, you're a Christian, and you see something, and the flesh said, that's what the flesh does. The flesh sees something. You know, you see something, and the flesh said, the landlord said, wait a minute, hold on. See, the landlord is the one that writes the contracts for the tenants. The landlord tells the tenants who they can visit, who they can let come in the house, and who can't come in the house. So the landlord says, when somebody knocks on the door, I'm going to answer the door because you tenants don't know who to let in the door. You know, as parents, when the doorbell rings, your children will go and open up the door and let anybody in the door. They'll let Joe Blow the butcher in your house if you're not careful. So first thing you do when the doorbell rings, you jump up and say, wait a minute, get back. I'll answer the door. And you go and you look in the peephole. And the times in which we live in, you better look out the peephole. You better look out the peephole. And then you better ask, who is it? And then you better keep the chain lock on it. And then you unlock all the locks. And then you look out, who is it? Why? Because you can't trust people now. Now what happens is this. When you get converted, you get a new landlord. Ellen White says it's the higher powers. The higher powers are now intelligent enough to talk with God. As you commune with God, God tells you what you should and should not do, and God begins to reveal his will to you for your life. He begins to point out certain things, and he shows you certain things. Now, there's a statement that I want to share with you right here in Desire of Ages. Kevin and I were talking this morning, and we were sharing, and we were just having a good time in the Lord. Now, this statement was not even in my notes, so I'm hoping that I'll stumble on it and find it. But I read it this morning. There it is. Praise the Lord. See how good the Lord is? He gave me this. Listen to this. Statement here. It is not God that blinds the eyes of men or hardens their hearts. He sends them light to correct their errors and to lead them in safe path. You see, what God does, he sends us light to correct our errors. If you're in darkness tonight, God is going to reveal himself to you. The problem is not God revealing his will to us. The problem is that I'm carnal and I'm still living in the natural man. I got to get converted in order to understand the things of God. Now listen to this statement here. It says, he sends them light. Praise God. Tonight, God is sending you light. You say, in the judgment, when you're going to be, we might be in the judgment, and we're going to say, well, God, when did you send me light? God's going to say, you remember Sunday night under that tent when that bald-head preacher came from the United States. That was light. You remember when he was talking about how he sends rays of light? God is going to send you the light. You see, God is not going to let you stay in the darkness. God is not going to play games with you. He's going to reveal to you his will. And tonight, let me say this. If I'm lost personally, I've come to the point in my personal walk with God that if I'm lost, it's by decision and not deception. That's scary. That's scary because that's an awesome responsibility. If I'm lost tonight, I know it will be because of decision and not deception. And you know what? Each one of us tonight are going to come to that same point somewhere in our experience. That's why the Bible says every knee is going to bow, every tongue is going to confess that, Lord, he's the Savior. He's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Listen to this statement, saints. I'm almost there. He sends them light to correct their errors and to lead them in safe path. It is by the rejection of this light that the eyes are blinded and the heart is hardened. I'll say that again. It is by rejection. God sends light, and I said, well, I ain't got to do all that. I'm going to do my own thing. I mean, here I am young. I ain't got to. No. It is by the rejection of this light that the eyes are blinded. Now, remember we said in Ephesians, we said God wants to give us a revelation so that our eyes of understanding can be open and enlightened. Well, what happens is when God sends light to my soul and I reject it, my heart becomes hardened. My eyes become blinded. Often, she says, the process is gradual. It doesn't happen overnight. It is a slow process. It's gradual. She says, almost imperceptible. Light comes to the soul through God's word, number one. Number two, through his servants. Number three, by the direct agency of his spirit. But when one ray of light, listen to this, saints. Now this is something. I'm talking to my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want you to hear this. When one ray of light is disregarded, I'll say that again. When one ray of light is disregarded, There is a partial benumbing of the spiritual perceptions. And the second revealing of light is less clearly discerned. God sends light and I don't accept it. The next time he sends light, I can't discern it. And so what happens is darkness takes place in my soul. Listen to this. So the darkness, she says, increases until it is night in the soul. Thus it had been with the Jewish leaders. They were convinced that a divine power attended Christ. But in order to resist the truth, they attributed the work of the Holy Spirit to Satan. In doing this, they deliberately chose deception. They yielded themselves to Satan, and henceforth they were controlled by his power. In this last statement, it says, it is not only by resistance, but by neglect that the soul is destroyed. Not only by resistance, but by neglect. What I fail to learn, what I don't do that I need to do, what I don't learn, what I need to learn. God says, here I am giving you privileges, I'm giving you opportunities, and you don't take advantage of it. Here I am opening up doors, and you won't come to know me. God says, here I am constantly revealing myself to you, but you won't come to me that you might have life. He said, I've come that you might have it, but you won't come to me, and I don't understand it. I'm doing everything I can do. In Isaiah, he says, what more could I have done that I have not already done? He said, I've given you my Bible. I've given you the spirit of prophecy. I've given you the word of God. What more can I do? You've got to receive the light. But the point is, you've got to be born again. That's what has to happen. Nicodemus told Jesus. Jesus said, a man must be born again. Jesus said, you've got to be born again. Nicodemus said, how can a man be born again when he's old? How can he enter into the mother's womb the second time? Jesus said, I'm not talking about that kind of born again. I'm talking about born from above. I'm talking about getting a new heart. I'm talking about getting a new mind. I'm talking about getting a relationship with God. That's what you got to have. And saints, if you don't have it, you've got to get on your knees and say, Lord, help me have an experience with you. Talk to my soul. Come near my heart. Come into my life. Reveal yourself to me. I know you're out there. I can feel you. I see you. I sense you. But somehow I don't have what it takes to hear your love for me. God says, if you come to me and you search for me with all your heart, you're going to find me. God says tonight, first of all, I'm going to reveal my love to you. I'm going to make myself known to you. I'm going to come in a special way. I may come through a Bible study. I may come through a track. I may come through a preacher's sermon. I may come through a friend. I may come through the word. I may come through the direct agency of the Holy Spirit. But the fact is, I'm going to come into your life. I'm going to reveal myself to you. I'm not going to force myself on you. I'm not going to make you serve me. But I'm going to come into your life, and you have to accept me or reject me. And what you do with me is going to determine the outcome of your life. That's why Thomas said, Father, Jesus, when Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. He says, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again. Jesus said, I'm coming back one day. And when I come back, I'm coming back for prepared people. He says, I'm coming back for you. And whither I go, you don't know. And he says, Thomas said, Lord, we know not where you're going. He says, how can we know the way? Jesus said, I'm glad you said that. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody can get to the Father but by me. Jesus said, I'm the only bridge over troubled water. If you got something in your life tonight that you're dealing with, young people, if you're going through some changes tonight, Jesus says, I am the way. I'm the way. If you got something on your heart that you can't even talk with your mother about or your father, Jesus says, I'm the way. If you're going through something and you don't know who to turn to, Jesus says, I'm the way. He says, if you don't know and you're in darkness and you're discouraged and you're despondent, he says, listen, I'm the way. I'm the truth. If you really want to know the truth, he says, check me out and the truth will set you free. Once you know the truth, my brothers and sisters, nobody can intimidate you. Nobody can hold you down. Nobody can call you to think less of yourself. When you know the truth, truth will set you free. And the truth is, tonight God loves you. He wants to save you. He's yearning over you. He's hungering for your soul. Kevin and I were talking about this just the other day, and we were sharing it with some of our young friends. In the Last Supper, when Judas had made a contract with the Pharisees to betray Jesus. Ellen White says that Jesus hungered for the soul of Judas. She says, in fact, he bathed his feet first. And I can imagine that Jesus knelt down and tenderly, patiently, lovingly caressed those feet that he knew were going to betray him. And you said if he knew he was going to betray him, then he was already predestined. No, God's foreknowledge does not ordain for us to do what we do. It only lets him know what we're going to do before we do it. He lovingly, patiently caressed those feet. He hungered for Judas. And Ellen White says Judas felt his love, but he would not repent. She says he felt the love of God. It melted his heart, but he refused to let go of his ways and went out and betrayed his Lord. Tonight, my brothers and sisters, I ask you this question. How much will it take for you to betray Jesus? They say the 30 pieces that Judas betrayed Jesus for, the equivalence of $12.60. You see, this is how it is. Here you are, born in the world of sin, and you're walking. And all of a sudden, what God says, all I want you to do is turn. That's all I want you to do. We're headed in the wrong direction. You and I, we're born headed in the wrong direction. Born bent towards hell. Born headed towards hell. Born with sin in us, iniquity. Born with sin in us. Born enemies against God. And God says, all I want you to do is turn. All I want you to do is stop. All I want you to do is turn around, my child. All I want to do is love you. Stop. You don't see where you're going. And that's why Ezekiel 33 verse 11 says this, our closing text. Turn there with me, saints. Ezekiel chapter 33 and verse 11. I'm so glad tonight we serve a loving God. I'm so glad tonight we serve a merciful God. I'm so glad tonight that God has not written us off. I'm so glad that all we've got to do is come to him and he will in no wise kick us out, cast us out. But notice what it says. These are the words of our Savior. Ezekiel chapter 33 and verse 11. Ezekiel 33 verse 11. Listen to what the Bible says tonight. Say unto them. Say unto who? Them. Talking about my people. Say unto my people, as I live, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way. Turn from his way. God says, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Why? He says, turn ye. Turn ye from your evil ways. Why will you die, O house of Israel? Why are you going to die in your sins when Jesus paid it all? Why are you going to die in your sins when Christ hung out on Calvary and said, it is finished? Why are you going to die in your sins when he paid the price, the penalty for sin, and he said, it is finished? My brothers and sisters, when Christ said it is finished, that is a bank term, which means the ultimate payment is paid in full. There is no more installment plans you have to make. There is no more payments for sin. Jesus paid it all. And when he hung out on the cross, he said, it's finished, it's done, it's through. No longer you have to be a slave. No longer do you have to make installment payments to the devil. It's finished. Jesus paid it all. He paid it in full. He made the balloon payment. He made the final payment. And now, tonight, you and I can be free. I like that song they sang. It talks about being free in Jesus. talks about now I'm free, I'm cleansed, I don't have any guilt in my soul, I don't have a wall separate me from my God. I can have fellowship with him, I can have relationship with him, I can talk with him again, I don't have to run from him, I can be at peace with my God. And when I walk out this tent tonight and look up at the twinkling stars, I can feel his love and know that he's not against me, he's for me. And the Bible says, if God justifies you, who gonna condemn you? If God is for you, who's against you? Paul says, I'm persuaded that nothing is gonna separate me from the love of God. I'm not gonna let anybody separate me from God. I'm not gonna let death or life or angels, principalities, things to come, past, present, I'm not going to let other people separate me from the love of God. I'm not going to let hypocrites separate me from the love of God. I'm not going to let unconverted folk run me out of the church. I'm going to stay where God wants me. I'm going to let him bless me. I'm going to love him to the end because he paid it all. Paid it all. Paid it all. Paid it all. And tonight he says, it's finished. You don't have to run any longer. You don't have to hide any longer. You can come out and you can talk with me. You can come to me. You can come just as you are. And tonight, they're probably going to sing something. I don't know. As she comes, if they're going to sing a little something. Tonight, I just want to make an appeal because somebody, the Lord has agitated my heart since I've been here. And that is, somebody need to make it right with the Lord. I don't know you and I don't know what you're going through, but the Lord has impressed me. I mean, he has really put a burden on my heart to make sure I make this altar call. And I can't let time run out. You know, I would like to make it some other time, but the Spirit of God has impressed me tonight that there is somebody here tonight that has not really made that calling to God sure. I don't know you, but I do know that God has pressed me. And tonight, I can't let this moment go by. I can't let this evening go by without giving you this appeal, this opportunity, whoever you are. And tonight, I know your palms might be sweating. I know your heart might be thumping. And I know you might be thinking, what will the people think? What were they going to think about me? Well, let me say this. If you don't accept Christ and you don't get it right, what do you think the universe is going to think? When you had an opportunity. Ellen White says, in the judgment, in a panoramic view, you're going to see everything from the day you were born to the day you die, how he gave you opportunities. She says it's going to be played right before you. Everything in your life, all the privileges, all the benefits, all the opportunities, all the rejections and all the acceptance, all of that is going to be played. And tonight, we want to make an appeal because, see, I've come here not to play church with you, but I've come here to help somebody get right with God. And the Spirit of God is moving in this place right now. I know the Spirit of God is on somebody's heart tonight, and you know you need to make it right tonight and say, Lord, I've been running. And I've been running because really I've never really understood your love for me. I've been hiding, doing things that I know I shouldn't do, and I've been abusing myself because I've been trying to quiet this pain in my heart. I've been trying to take care of the acute pain, but there's a chronic illness in my soul, and I'm separated from you, and all I need to do is come back home. And I'm so glad that you sent somebody to call me, and tonight, whoever you are, in the quietness of this moment, in this moment tonight, you may say, Lord Jesus, I love you and I want to just give you my life and I want to walk with you. I want to be converted. I want you to come into my life. I want a new heart. I want a clean heart tonight. You can come tonight as my brother sings for us tonight. I'm going to stand here and wait on you. If you can't come, if you don't have the strength to come, just raise your hand. I'll come get you because it means that much to me and Jesus. But tonight you want to say, Lord, I want to accept you into my life. I want to become your child. I want to become all that you want me to become in this life. Tonight as they sing, as he sings this beautiful song tonight, why don't you make up in your mind to give Jesus your life? Right now, why don't you come? Why don't you come? Whoever you are, just come right now. Come right down to the front and make up in your mind that you're going to walk with Jesus tonight. Whoever you are.
Why don't you sing with me now? Our theme song for this camp, I Will Run to You.
I see you, Jesus. That's one thing you've got to promise tonight to the Lord. I praise God for these precious, wonderful, beautiful souls that have come up to say, Lord, I want to walk with you. I want to talk with you. They're making a commitment tonight. And tonight there may be somebody else who still needs to come. But before we close out tonight, we want to make sure you're given the opportunity. Tonight is nothing like having peace with your God. It's nothing like knowing that you have a clean slate with God. Praise God. And he, you know what? God takes the balance of your life and he gives you a clean slate to start all over again. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and he's just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's faithful. He's just to cleanse us. The Bible says that if we just come to him, he says, come now, let's reason together. Let's talk about it. He says, you are covered with sins. He says, I'll make you white as wool. I'll make you white as snow. He says, I'll fix your problem, but you got to come to me. And tonight, he says, if you just run the race until I see your face, oh, let me live in the glory of your grace. That's beautiful. The Bible says tonight, Jesus says, all I want to do is give you life. That's all. He wants to bless us. The devil walked away from God in light of his blessings, in light of the glory, in light of all that God revealed to Lucifer. He walked out on it. And I'm so glad tonight that God said, wait a minute. I'm going to make man in my image and I'm going to love man, but man dogged God. Man walked out on God, but God said they were deceived. I know down in January the 11th, 1998, there's going to be somebody who's going to want to serve me. There's going to be somebody who's going to want to come back. And I'm going to make a way for whoever want to come back. They can come tonight. There's amnesty with God. God has opened up the door and he says, tonight you don't have to run from me. I'm a lawyer that never lost a case. And I'll represent you if you just come to me. Praise God tonight for these precious, precious souls. Tonight we want to pray. There may be those of you out in your seats who say, Lord, I'm already a Christian and I just want more power. I just want to be faithful. I don't want to be lost. I want to see your face. I want to run to you, Lord, when you come back. I want to be able to say, Lord, this is my God. I've waited for him and he's going to save us. If that's your desire tonight, why don't you stand with me? Don't stand because everybody's standing, but I want you to stand with me if you want to say, Lord, I love you and I just want to be ready when you come back. I just want more power. I want to be faithful in the little things so that you can make me faithful over much. That's why you're standing tonight. Praise God. Praise God. We want to make sure we get the names of these individuals, I guess, so that we can find out their desires, whether it's for baptism or for commitment or rededication. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Loving Lord, our Savior. Oh Lord, tonight I thank you so much for Jesus Christ. I thank you, my God, for just coming by this place, this tent. I thank you, Lord, for our youth director, Gervais. I thank you, Lord, for his staff, his workers, his secretary, Tracy, and others who support him in all that he does with the youth ministries. Tonight, Father, I thank you for this canvas. I thank you, Lord, for the singers. I thank you for the fellowship. I thank you for the people of God. Tonight, once again, Lord, we felt your spirit. We felt your power. We've heard your voice calling us home. And Lord, tonight, these precious souls have responded to your invitation. Oh, Lord, tonight, I ask that you would seal them with your power. I ask tonight, Lord, that you would comfort them with your joy. Lift them up by your strength and hold them by your grace. Lord, there are others standing, Lord, in the pews, in the seats, in the chairs. They're standing tonight, Father, because they want more power to live for you. Grant them your anointing, I pray. And Lord, save us at last when you come. Help us, Lord, as we walk on earth, that we would keep our eyes stayed on you, that you might keep us in perfect peace. Oh, Jesus, tonight we bless your holy name. We love you for your goodness. We adore you for your grace. And Lord, tonight, thank you for your love. Bless us to this end and keep us, Father, as we experience your grace throughout this encampment this week. Thank you for saving us and cleansing us. In Jesus' name, all of God's people said together, amen and amen.